On to business. It is my great honor and pleasure to introduce to some and present to others Dr. Marc Lamont Hill. He's one of the leading intellectual voices in the country. He's the host of HuffPost Live and BET News, as well as a political contributor on CNN. Dr. Hill is a distinguished professor of African American Studies at Morehouse College. Prior to that, he held positions at Columbia University and Temple University. I've observed this brother for years. I've made his acquaintance more closely these last few months. Always been impressed by him. It was a great accomplishment for our provost, Dr. Campbell, to work out a situation where he can come to Morehouse and join the faculty. He's excited to be here. We're excited to have him here. He is a faculty member and wants to engage you as such. Very approachable, down-to-earth brother, okay? So we need to engage him in that way. If you would please join me in welcoming to the podium Dr. Marc Lamont Hill.
Thank you, Dr. Marc. Good morning, everybody. Man, this is almost unreal to me to be here right now. The last time I was in Crown Forum was 18 years ago, sitting over there in the middle trying to figure out how I could leave early. And it's been a long journey to make it back to Morehouse. And to be here at Crown Forum means a great deal to me. In the time that I'm here, in the time we have, I want to talk to you all a little bit about the theme of this year, which is responsibility. And I want us to think about responsibility in a few different ways. Because oftentimes in the world, when people talk about responsibility, they only want to talk about responsibility to respectability. Responsibility to our parents, responsibility to institutions, and I think all of those things are important, but I think we can think about responsibility in a range of ways. And for me, the thing that always brings me back is this idea of home. Figuring out what home is, where home is, what home looks like, how home is formed, and how we get there and how we stay there. And so I want to tell a couple of stories, because that's the tradition I come out of, that make me think of home, that help me understand what home is and how we can create a greater sense of responsibility to Morehouse, which is home, to this area, which is home, to our community, which is home, to this nation, which is home in a certain kind of way, and to the global community, which presents its own kind of existential home. And so the first thing I would do is say that when I got here at Morehouse, because that's where it all started for me, my journey into the world that I'm in now, my journey back to Crown Forum really begins with me arriving here on campus freshman year, fall of 96. And I remember it because I had no idea why I was in college. My brother had gone here and graduated from here, and my parents said, you can go to college, you need to go to college. College was not something that was an option. College was necessary for me, but I didn't know exactly where I was going to end up or why. And in high school, I had pretty much majored in basketball. That's all I did. No, that's all I did for 4 years of high school was play basketball, and I got offered some basketball scholarships, and my parents wouldn't let me take basketball scholarships because they were worried that all I would do is play basketball and not read any books because they had seen me in high school. And so they said, well, you can't go to a college on a basketball scholarship, you can go to Morehouse. It's a great school. Our family's been there. Go to Morehouse. So I went to Morehouse, and I said, I'm going to show my mom. I'm going to just walk on the team. They can't do nothing if I walk on the team. So I went to the – back then it was Coach McAfee. Coach Brewer was sort of coaching, but he was the assistant coach, and Coach McAfee was there. And I went to practice and showed up for a few days, and I made the cut, and then we made it down to 14. I made the cut. Coach Brewer said, boy, you're nice, but I don't think you're too bright. He said, hey, you done that play 3 times and it didn't work. Why don't you try something else? And so I tried something else, and I tried something else, and I kept playing, and eventually we ultimately couldn't agree, basically. Me and the coach didn't agree. I thought I was good, and he didn't. So basketball sort of ended for me. basketball ended for me, and I didn't know what to do. I didn't know where to go. I didn't know how I was going to maneuver through the world, because my whole identity was surrounded around being a basketball player and pursuing basketball, and I didn't have any grand aspirations of going to the NBA. And Coach Brewer told me I could redshirt and come back the next year, and I didn't want to go to practice if I wasn't going to play, so I quit. And then I went through the year, I finished my freshman year, came here for sophomore year. I'm sitting in class, and I remember sitting there in intro to AP psychology, or honors psychology, rather. And I was sitting in class, and they started talking about homework and assignments and books, and I started thinking, man, what's the point of being here if I'm not going to be playing basketball? Because that's why I came to college. So in the middle of class, I got up, and I walked out. It was like day three, I think. And I went to the bursar's office. I went to the registrar. There's about 50,000 people in line. One person working. Ain't nothing changed. And I waited in line. I finally said, you know what? I'm going to quit. I said, I'm going to withdraw. They said, you sure you want to do that? You sure you don't want to talk to somebody? And I thought about people I could have talked to. I could have talked to Professor Bennett, because Harold Bennett was my mentor, and I had taken several classes with him. I had taken intro to Old Testament. I had taken intro to religion. I had taken a bunch of courses with him my first year, and he was so smart and challenging. And I knew if I went to him, he was going to tell me to stay. So I was like, I ain't going there. So I went to somebody else, an English professor, and I went to talk to him. And he said, you should definitely not leave, because most people who leave don't come back. And I had just been to freshman orientation the year before, and they had told me, look to your left, look to your right. One of them people ain't going to be here. It turned out I was going to be that person. And I didn't want to be that person, but also didn't want to stay in school because I didn't see the purpose or the function in it, and so I withdrew. Now, if you withdraw, and I don't know if it's still like this, but back then, if you withdraw on the first day, you get your money back. Okay, well, that might be called the Marc Lamont Hill rule, because they gave me my money back. And they gave me a check for, it was like $5,000. I was out of state. They gave me like $5,000. Now, that check probably should have gone to my mother, since she wrote the check. But I decided, I was 18 at the time now, and I said, you know what, maybe, can somebody do me a favor? Dr. Livingston, can you tap the brother behind you? He seems to be dozing. Thank you. And so I got the check for $5,000, and I said, well, I could start my life without college. So the first thing I did was I went down to Stewart Avenue. Now it's Metropolitan Avenue. That ain't what I did now. It wasn't in ones. But I digress. I went to a buy here, pay here lot and bought me a 1994 Geo Metro. I ain't had no car before. And I gave him $4,500. And I had to make payments on it after that. The car had 135,000 miles on it. It was 2 years old, had 135,000 miles on it. Now, I thought it had 35,000 miles on it, because after them cars weren't made to go past 100, so it reset and started over again. The car was about this big. So I gave him my $45,000. He brought the car over to me, set it down. I'm rolling now. I got me a car. I had moved up to Buckhead just my sophomore year. I moved out of the dorm. I had stayed in Du Bois first year. Second year, I decided to do that. So I had a crib. I had a car. I ain't had no job. So I decided I needed to get me a hustle. I had $500 in my pocket, and I said I need to invest in something. Now, I didn't want to sell drugs. Now, my brother sold drugs. Been in jail most of my life, most of my adult life. I knew drugs wasn't for me. I wanted a legal hustle. So I decided I was going to sell incense. It seemed like a good idea at the time, so I went and got my $500, went down to MLK, walked in the store, got me $500 worth of incense, which was about 1 million incense. And I set up shop. I went up to Lenox Mall, Lenox train station. We'll park my little Geo Metro in front of the train station, and I would sell incense every day. And I was doing all right. You know, you sell about 50 incense for like $1, $2. Back then, gas was only 89 cents a gallon, so, you know, I could fill up my gas tank, go. I sound old, but it's really true. It was 89 cents a gallon, and it was a Geo Metro. It was like a lawnmower, so it took about 5 gallons to fill up. And then I drive up to Lenox Mall and I sell my incense every day. Now we in September. By the end of September, we into October. Something weird happened. And I learned this about parents. Parents are real strange. They can be real shady sometimes. If you take their $5,000, they stop paying your rent. I know, it's terrible. And so by the end of October, I didn't have a place to stay. They had put gave me the red slip, the yellow slip, then they put the lock on the door. Then they put all my stuff out in front of the Lenox Forest apartments. And so I didn't have no place to stay. And so then I decided, well, I'll live in my car until I make other arrangements, until this incense business really starts to take off. So now I'm sleeping in the back of the Geo Metro, and it's not really the back, I'm sleeping in the whole Geo Metro. And I'm selling stuff, but I'm not exactly, the month was lasting longer than my money. So I remember one day I walked across the street to Houston's to get me a veggie burger, and I came out, and I realized another lesson, which is that car dealerships also can be really, really funny acting, man. Like, if you don't make that payment every week, every month, they take the car. And so I turned around and looked outside of Houston's, and they were towing away my Geo Metro with the incense in it. So now I'm in Atlanta, and I have no place to go. At least in my mind, I don't have any place to go. Now, the first thing I would tell you all about this before I get into the real point of this is that I probably should have made a different decision. So often, the decisions we make are instantaneous and we don't seek wise counsel, and that's sort of what happened. And so now, I'm staying in Lenox Mall train station, and I'm sleeping in Lenox Mall train station. And a week goes by, and 2 weeks goes by, and 3 weeks goes by, and it's getting colder. People say Atlanta's not cold. That's true if you're inside. But I was sleeping on the train station floor, and it got worse, and it got colder, and it got colder. And then there was one night as it got colder and colder that really radically reorganized my life and radically changed the way I saw the world, the way I saw myself, and it completely reoriented and redirected my journey. I was staying in the train station one night. It was especially cold that night. I remember it was about 30 to 40 degrees. It was a little unseasonably cold. And I was sleeping on the train station floor, and I felt something hitting me in my stomach and then hitting me in my ribs. It felt like an elbow or something or a knee, and at first I ignored it. And I ignored it because sometimes when you sleep on a train station floor, people throw things at you, people kick you, people abuse you, and that's exactly what was happening. And to be quite honest, after a few weeks of it, I had gotten sort of used to it. And so I didn't exactly respond right away. It might have been 5 minutes or 8 minutes or 10 minutes, and then finally I felt this thing continuing to hit me, and I finally woke up and I looked to my right, and there was a gentleman there who also slept on the train station floor. He was a Vietnam War veteran. He had been there before. In fact, when I was out there selling incense, when I was living in Lenox Forest up the street paying rent, I would go by there and see him on my way to Phipps or to Lenox Mall. And so I knew him, and I kind of understood him, and I thought he was a little odd because he would talk to himself sometimes, and he always wore green fatigues. But this night, he kept elbowing me, and he kept elbowing me, and I finally woke up, and I said, "What do you want?" He said, "Wake up." I said, "I'm up." He said, "You got to get up." I said, "I am up. What do you want?" He said, "Get up." I said, "What do you want?" He said, "You do not belong here." And I said, "Got someplace else for me to go? I'm open to options." He said, "That's not what I mean." He said, "You don't belong here. This isn't your home." Oftentimes, we craft homes for ourselves based on where we are physically. But that's not what home is. He said, "You're trying to live a life that you ain't got to do." He said, as crazy as it sounds, he said, "I have to be here. I have to be here. You don't." I said, "I have nowhere else to go." He said, "No, you think you don't have anywhere else to go because you've decided that you're going to be something that you ain't got to be. This is not your home." Now, as black people in America, as African people, we've always been visitors to a strange land. We've always inhabited a place that we always wanted to be in, but not of. We were part of America, we built America, but we were never trying to become the thing that America made us or exploited us to become. And so there's always this navigation as African people about being in a place but not of it. Some of you will go into corporate America and be in a place but not of it. Some of you will be in schools and institutions, you'll be in those places but not of it. I go on TV, when I was on Fox News, I was in it, but I damn sure wasn't of it. So the idea is, how do you figure out where you're supposed to be? And so I looked to this man and I said, what am I supposed to do? He said, be yourself. Now, the first thing I had to do before I could even get to that piece of advice was to listen to him. I had to actually stop what I was doing and listen to him. One of the challenges of being in this world is that we often are taught that certain people are worth listening to and other people are not. Intuitively, I thought this man on the train station floor had nothing to offer me because of the clothes that he came in, the body he came in, the frame that he came in, the language that he articulated. But the truth is, he gave me the most profound wisdom I ever received. But we've entered a world where we're taught that certain voices don't matter. We're taught that poor people's voices don't matter. We have elections in 2008 and 2012 where poor people are talking and nobody's listening. Democrats and Republicans are talking about how they can deliver the middle class, how they can save the middle class, how they can help the middle class. People are talking about tax abatements and relief for the wealthy, but nobody is saying poor people's name. We don't have to listen to them. Black and brown people all across the world, their voices are rendered mute. As we talk about injustice, as we talk about pain, as we talk about the stories of our lives, people say, those voices don't matter. People on train station floors, we talk that their voices don't matter. Some of you will graduate. Most of y'all, all of y'all will graduate if y'all do the Crown Forum. Y'all all will graduate from Morehouse College. And when you graduate from Morehouse College, you will be told that you are the best and the brightest, and you are. But that does not mean that you can ever stop listening to the folk who got you here. People who prayed for you to be here. People who were the deacons and deaconesses in your church. People who lived on the block. People who sacrificed for you, who struggled for you, who worked for you, who could never be in this place, but they were of this place. But we live in a world that tells us to forget all of that. Get amnesia. You start thinking you're here just because you're special. Because you're just smarter than everybody else. Like it wasn't somebody just as smart on your block that wrote rhymes in their notebook every day and school told them they were illiterate. Like there wasn't some kid in the corner store counting change without a register, but school told them that they couldn't do math. Like it wasn't somebody that made a sacrifice that stood in the gap for you to be here. Your challenge is the next generation of black leadership is to never stop listening. And also to never stop getting America to listen to us. The legacy of the black freedom struggle has been that we've always gotten America to listen to us so that America could listen to itself, to keep track of its own democratic promises, to keep track of its own utterances of freedom and possibility. We got to make them, as African people, we have a responsibility to make America be honest with itself. David Walker's appeal to the colored citizens of the world. David Walker's appeal to preamble together four articles to the colored citizens of the world, but particularly and most expressly those of the United States. He made a preamble and he made four articles. He was modeling it after what? The Constitution. Why? Because in a signifying tradition, he wanted America to understand that it had articulated democratic promises that were not being kept with the unfree Negro. When you read the narrative of the life of Gustavus Vassa, Olatokiano, or Gustavus Vassa, written by himself, and he's articulating through a signifying tradition the kind of contradiction between the Christian traitor, the person who's occupying a tradition of Jesus, but who isn't following the love ethic of Jesus that Howard Thurman teaches us about. How are you Christian on the one hand and keeping slaves on the other? Peep the end of the book where he says written by himself. That wasn't an axiomatic phrase. It wasn't axiomatic. It wasn't self-evident. It wasn't an obvious truth. He wrote written by himself because the idea that the Negro could read and write a book wasn't taken for granted. When Phyllis Wheatley wrote poems on various subjects, religious and moral, people thought she couldn't have written it because they said a Negro, and certainly not a Negro woman, is capable of doing this. They had a trial for her. Because they couldn't listen to a Negro. They couldn't listen to profound truths from a Negro voice because they couldn't hear it. Phyllis Wheatley made them listen. And even if we don't like being brought from Africa to America, 'twas mercy that brought me from my pagan land. We still appreciate the fact that she could write African letters into existence when we forced them to listen. Written by himself is a way of us forcing America to listen to its contradictions. You say Negroes don't have the capacity to read, Thomas Jefferson notes on Virginia. You say Negroes ain't got the capacity to learn how to read, Hegel, Kant, Hume, pick one, anyone, Jordan, Jackson, they all said we couldn't read. Yet you make laws committed to stopping us from learning how to read. The contradiction of saying people are lazy but making them slaves, of saying they're dirty but having them clean your houses, of saying that they're uncivilized but having them raise your children. Listen to yourself. But that's an easy moral project. Try listening to the poor person up the block. Try listening to the baby mama up the street. Try listening to the dope boy in the SWATs. That's your moral challenge, middle class. And if you ain't middle class now, you're gonna be when you leave here. So I listened to him. And he said to me, be yourself. I said, all right. Who am I? He said, fool, if you don't know how, I'm going to tell you. Being yourself seems like the easiest thing to be. But on the other hand, it's the daggone most difficult thing to be. Because we live in a world that is always telling us who and what we are, who and what we're supposed to be. The idea of being yourself is something that we struggle with in African letters, we struggle with in activism, we struggle in our spiritual traditions to try to figure out who we are in the context of madness. You walk into the store in the mall, and the mannequin is a size zero. Don't look like nobody. You grew up with a Barbie doll. Or if men, you didn't have dolls, you had action figures. We call them, there's another way of saying doll, right? It's make you feel better about your masculinity. I mean, same assembly line, same plastic, we just painted a different color. They don't look like us. The world is telling you to look like something that you can't even be. We in the blackest city in the world, and you go into a drugstore and buy a flesh-colored Band-Aid. It's peach. The world is telling you what normal skin is supposed to look like, not you. Every image of the world that tells you what beauty looks like, that tells you what power looks like, that tells you what intelligence looks like, that tells you what grace looks like, doesn't look like you. So what does it mean to be yourself in the world that tells you that you, black man, are violent, that you, black man, are immoral, that you, black man, are hypersexual? How do you be yourself in the midst of that? How do you keep that madness at bay? That's what I was trying to figure out. The man and I didn't get into that nuance of an existential philosophical conversation on a train station floor. But what he damn sure said to me is, you got to figure out who you are and not listen to nobody else. And that's the journey that you go through, the folding and unfolding of life that you never complete. I'm 36 years old. I'm still figuring out who I am. But I know what I'm not. And I know what I want to continue to try to be and do and unlearn. And as black men, the thing you have to do as you continue to be yourself is to unlearn all these ugly scripts about ourselves that we are taught we must be. That to be a man, you must be devoid of emotion. That you can't cry, that you can't express longing or desire, that you can't fall in love, that you can only resolve your conflicts through violence, that you can only be heterosexual, that you can't identify as trans or bi or gay, that you can't occupy a space in the world that's different. There's a whole lot of ways the world tells you who you have to be. You got to shake that stuff off. When the Honorable Elijah Muhammad emerged in 1931, he was given six words: accept your own and be yourself. This is your own. You got to figure out who you're going to be. And so I turned to him and I said, I'm not sure what I want to be. I said, but I think I want to be a professor. He said, why do you want to be a professor? And I thought back to Crown Forum. I sat here 18 years ago. And I was sitting in the middle aisle. And there was a guy standing right here. And he was talking. And he was lecturing. And he brought in Plato and Aristotle right here in Crown Forum. And then he brought in Biggie. And then he brought in Nas. And then Tupac had just died 2 weeks before. And he started talking about Tupac, and then he brought in Howard Thurman, and he sat there, and I watched him do what he did, and I turned to my best friend, R. LaRue Lewis McCoy, who's a professor now himself, and we turned to each other and said, I don't know what that Negro is doing, but that's what I want to do. And it was Michael Eric Dyson standing here. I had never met him. I didn't encounter him again. We didn't even talk after Crown Forum, because like my man who I saw earlier, I said, I'm trying to leave as soon as this is over. And I turned around and I left, but in my mind I had imprinted this idea that there's a pathway and a life that I could live that I'd never even considered before. That's what Crown Forum is about, by the way. The opportunity to see people up here who have a message, who have a word, who have an idea, who have a commitment that you might not even know you want right now, but later on it might matter. And I was on that floor and I said, I think I want to be a professor. He said, be a professor then. I said, okay, I'll be a professor. He said, so what next? I said, well, the problem is I got to go back to school. And it's too late. It's too late. I'm 19. I'm too old. To be a professor, he said, what you got to do? I said, I got to go back and finish undergrad. I got to go to grad school. It might take me 10 years to be a professor. I got to get a PhD to be a professor. He said, well, go back to school. I said, it's going to take me 10 years to do all that. He said, dummy, 10 years going to go by anyway. You just ain't going to have a PhD. That made a whole lot of sense. So often in this world, we're so obsessed with time. I can't do this because it's going to take too long. I can't engage in this journey because it's going to be too difficult. But time moves anyway. Believe me, I can't believe that 18 years have passed since the last time I was in this room. I can't believe that 45 years have passed since Dr. Marx was in this room as a freshman. Do not let time be the enemy of your dreams, but we live in a world where what anthropologists call time-space compression, where everything moves faster. We were talking before this, when we sit when we sat in Crown Forum, we couldn't text nobody like you're doing right there. We couldn't text nobody. We couldn't play on Instagram or Twitter or Facebook. We just had to sit here. But now, everything is moving faster. When I was in high school, we had pen pals. We had no Facebook where you could write on somebody's wall or poke somebody, whatever that means. Pause. We didn't have YouTube to communicate with people around the globe. We didn't have Instagram to post pictures of our food or ourselves. We didn't have any of that. We had pen pals. You write a letter to some girl in Iowa in September, she writes you back in November, I like ice cream too. You write each other back in April, and then the relationship is over. But the world has gotten faster. The world has gotten bigger in the sense that you can access more of it. It's gotten smaller in the sense that you can get to it more quickly. And in the midst of that, you all have a sense of urgency and speed about everything. When I got an email here at Morehouse, I had to go down 5 flights of steps, stand in line, give a secret handshake, and then they gave me a 20-mile-long email address. And only like 4 other people had email. Now you have the opportunity to email people on campus, to talk to your professor. A student will email you on at noon and be like, at 2 o'clock, why aren't you responding? Why are you ignoring me? You all have so much access that you have a sense of urgency. And urgency is good when you're starting a revolution. Urgency is good when you want to get to Crown Forum on time, which half of y'all didn't. But in terms of your life goals, you need to not just have revolutionary technology and revolutionary energy and revolutionary ideas. You also need revolutionary patience. Revolutionary patience. Some of you are right now freshmen saying, I would love to be a doctor, but it's going to take me 9 years. Homie, 9 years is going to go by anyway. You're just not going to be a doctor. 7 years is going to go by anyway. You're just not going to be a lawyer. That fifth year going to happen anyway. You're just not going to have that extra engineering degree. That fifth year just going to happen. You're just not going to have that master's. Time is going to go by anyway. Do not let time be the enemy of what you're going to do. We come from a tradition of people that worked and fought and struggled and died, not even for a world that they would see, but for a world that their children or their children's children would see. That's revolutionary patience. All y'all got to do is wait an extra year for a master's degree. I think y'all can do that. And so I turned to him and I said, well, what do I do now? I'm fine, I'll go back to school, but they're going to laugh at me. They're going to make fun of me. They're going to say I told you so. I don't even know if they're going to let me back in. I won't use the language that he used in the chapel. He said, forget them. He said, there will always be people. There will always be people who are committed to your failure. There will always be people who are obsessed with watching you not shine. Your generation sort of constructed this and framed this brilliantly, right, with the term hater. Because it's not just jealousy. It seems deeper, right? Like, they're actually upset that things are going well for you. They don't just want what you have. They're actually mad that you're happy. Now, the hater can be a simple person just mad that you got on new Jordans or something like that. I ain't talking about that. I think there's a more fundamental way we can think about what it means to be black and male in a world that sees both of those things as problematic. What does it mean to occupy a world where a person does not see your very humanity? Because that's the problem with Michael Brown, right? It's not just that the officer Darren Wilson shot him. Maybe Darren Wilson did think he was a threat 100 feet away with flip-flops and his hands up. Maybe George Zimmerman really did think that the Skittles and the hoodie was a legitimate existential threat to him. That's not to excuse the behavior. There's nothing exculpatory about white supremacist irrational fear. My point is, you live in a world where your very bodies are marked as dangerous even when you got a hoodie. You live in a world where your bodies are seen as a lethal threat even when your arms are in the air. You live in a world where even if you have the same grades and go to a better school, they still will think you're not capable of doing this work. There's a more fundamental kind of hate that this world has for black men that doesn't hinge upon whether or not it's a conspiracy, whether or not there's 5 men in a room twirling their mustache and saying bad things about you, or whether or not there are simply systemic, deeply entrenched systems in place that make it possible for black misery to be normalized. Because that's what we got to worry about, right? I don't care why the police officer shoot me with my hands up. I'm mad that I'm getting shot. I don't care why my son or daughter is more likely to be suspended, expelled, or kicked out or put in special ed than their white counterparts with the same IQ scores and behavior. I'm not worried about why. I'm worried about the fact that it happens. There's a core kind of hate that's entrenched in the world that you all have to respond to. You can't forget about it, but you have to acknowledge, one, that it's not real. That the threats, that the logic is unmerited, even if the consequence is real. In other words, yes, there are real things in the world we have to deal with, and we have to respond to them, and we have to shake them off by keeping them at arm's length, but we also have to be active in the world in doing the work of eliminating the narratives that normalize anti-black hate, anti-black racism. Y'all follow what I'm saying? There's a level of hate that occupies the world, but it ain't exclusive to black men. The world hates black women. Look at Renisha McBride in Detroit. The world hates trans people. Look at Cece McDonald in Minnesota. You all have a responsibility to uproot hate, to shift it. Not in a pie in the sky and a grape by and by way. I mean by doing active system level work to end oppression. And on an interpersonal level, you all have to shake off a world and a community of people that will say he ain't no good just because you're doing something right. Of people who will, when you start to get your grades together, who might say, oh, he not cool no more. Of people who might suggest that you're identifying as something other than your own authentic self because you decide not to smoke weed or not to have unprotected sex or to actually be in love with one person in one relationship. Somehow you compromise an authentic masculinity by loving somebody. You all have to have the commitment and the courage to shake all off all of that hate and do something else. And I know I gotta go, I'm gonna take my seat, but I sat on that floor and I said, all right, I ain't worried about the haters. I'm not worried about the bad news. I ain't worried about none of that. But we still on the train station floor. What do I do now? He said, go home. He said, go home. Home. I didn't know what home was anymore. I didn't think I could go back to Philadelphia. I grossly underestimated the power of a mother's love, believe me. I didn't know what home was or where home was. He said, well, it's not here. Home is not merely about place. It's also about space. It's not just about the built environment, it's about what's inside of the built environment. For the next 4 years, Morehouse will be home to you if you allow it to be. But there will be other homes that you have. Some of you don't have a home when you go home because of who you are. Because of how you identify, because of what you care about, or just because your parents is trifling. Some of you have been in 15 houses, ain't found a home yet. James Baldwin said in Giovanni's room, he said, perhaps home is not a place, but instead an irrevocable condition. Perhaps home is something inside of here. Perhaps home is something that we constantly have to shape and reshape and reimagine in ways that not just redeem ourselves, but perhaps redeem the entire world. Perhaps home is something that we can reimagine in a way that allow us to be our best selves. Now, I didn't have that much insight on that train station floor at 19. I just got in my homeboy's car and drove back to Philadelphia. And I worked 2 and 3 jobs, and I took 24 credit hours every semester. And I rushed to complete undergrad, and by hook or by crook, I got into the University of Pennsylvania. I still don't know how that happened, but I got into the University of Pennsylvania, and I started my PhD program. I still wasn't sure what I wanted to do. I just knew that I loved ideas. The year before, I had taken a class called The Black Woman in undergrad. I wanted to meet black women. Seemed appropriate, but instead I encountered Black Feminist Thought by Patricia Hill Collins. And it changed my life, not just because I began to understand the world in different terms and I began to try to deconstruct patriarchal masculinity, but also because I decided I wanted to read and write for a living. Because after coming home and working, I kind of forgotten about my professor dreams. And then that reminded me that those professor dreams were still valid, and so I went to graduate school, and I don't know, we got to go, and I stood there, and I got to graduate school, and the first year, I was still figuring it out, and then the second year, somebody came up to me and said, you know what, guess who just arrived on campus? I said, who? They said, Michael Eric Dyson. the guy I saw in Crown Forum when I was a freshman. And I took that as a sign that perhaps I was home. And for the next 3 years, I did the work of working with him and learning from him and mentoring him. And deciding that you could use a PhD to help somebody. That this life of the mind isn't just a kind of intellectual masturbatory project that only makes me feel good about myself, but might actually make the world better too. And so I did that work, and I began to struggle, and I began to sacrifice, and I began to build, and I built a career that I'm proud of, and I still got a lot of work to do. I got a lot of personal stuff to fix. I got a lot of brokenness I got to heal. But I continued to do that work, and then this summer, Provost Campbell called me. 18 years after I left this place thinking that I could never return home. 18 years after I thought the possibility of completing a circle could never happen. 18 years after struggling and falling and making bad choices, I got a phone call out of the blue, and he said, "Do you want to come back?" I said, "Come back where?" He said, "Home." Thank you for welcoming me home, Morehouse. God bless you.
All right, aren't you glad you came? All right, tell your friends. They can learn something at Crown Forum. Spread the word. All right, real quick attendance note, you got index cards. What we need you to do is put your first name, last name, and M number on the index card. First name, last name, M number. There are going to be boxes in the lobby in the back. Just drop it in the box on your way out. That's it, okay?